I'm not talking without my union rep.
Look, I read your report. I just want to hear it from you. It's just a conversation.
I've been where you're at. My second day on the streets, I'm out with my TO. White dude. Routine traffic stop. Only the kid in the passenger seat takes off running. So I give chase. Catch him pretty quick, but he starts fighting me. My TO just stands there watching, wants to see if a girl can handle herself. I get the upper hand when suddenly the kid is reaching for something behind him. My TO is frozen, yells gun. I draw and I shoot this kid in the chest. Only there's no gun, just a cell phone. 18 years old. But I told the truth. At least I had that.
And you were cleared?
Rule justifiable. I reasonably feared for my life.
Hello, guys.
Hi.
Hey, please make some noise one more time. Sanaa Lathan, Mack Wilds. So, a 10-hour film.
Pretty much.
That was the talk on set when I was shooting. It's not a show, it's a film.
Exactly.
A film. We were not allowed to say episodes. We got fined.
Yes.
Yeah. The first word.
Exactly.
And what an undertaking, because initially Gina Bythewood wanted to pitch it as a 10-hour film.
Absolutely.
But they decided to make it a procedural. Yeah. So talk about like doing it in this way as compared to having, hey, let's just all chill out at the theater and watch this for 10 straight hours.
Well, the great thing about this is there's a beginning. It really is a movie. It's a beginning, a middle, and an end. So there is an end to this story. It was kind of the inception of it was about 4 or 5 years ago. Reggie Bythewood, who's also our creator, along with Gina, they're married. About 4 or 5 years ago, they were watching the Zimmerman, Trayvon Martin trial. And when Zimmerman got off, hit their son, Cassius, who's 12, was in tears. He didn't understand, like, you know, he was killed. Why did he get off? So Reggie showed him a documentary about Emmett Till. And that was kind of like the beginnings of an education about what's going on, what happens with race in our country. And Cassius wrote a beautiful poem about Trayvon meeting Emmett Till in heaven.
That's really sweet.
And it actually makes it to the series. But that was the seed of the idea of our show. And at that point, they thought it was going to be a movie. Mm-hmm. So when the opportunity came up for Fox, Fox came to Gina and they just wanted to work with her. This was kind of like the perfect segue.
And it seems like it's the perfect procedural or the perfect film for the times. And a lot of what you all were shooting were being almost felt like they were being ripped out of the headlines. I remember you all talking about shooting over the summer and Philando Castile and Altered Sterling going on at the same time. Yeah. Like, what's the gravity of that going into set every single day but reading the headlines and realizing, oh, we're depicting real life here?
You know, it takes a lot out of you. You know, it's one of those unfortunate things where even when you're off of work, even when, you know, they say cut and you go home, it's never really over. You go home, you turn the TV on, it's on your news, it's on the channels, it's on your social media feeds, it's everywhere. So this was one of those well, for me, this was one of the roles that probably took the most out of me, because you were so vested in it every single moment that you were in, that you were doing it. You know, it felt like there wasn't a time that you wouldn't turn the TV on and hear about another killing. Or
the record number of murders by police in July, and that was our last month of the shooting.
Yeah, it was crazy.
And one thing I want to touch back onto the genesis of the show, which had come up from the Bythewood son. And it's always like this conversation. I remember when my father took me aside and spoke to me about police. I know the common question is to find out when the man found out, black man, but I also feel like we need to talk to our black women, our daughters too. And Sanaa, did your father ever speak to you about dealing with police?
You know, I don't remember a talk, but you just know coming up as a black person in this country, right? You just know. And there was a scene, you know, this was a very grueling shoot. It's a 10-hour movie that we shot in the course of what it takes to do one movie. So 4 months, usually it's like one movie. So it was a very fast pace, and you know, the scripts were being written as we were shooting. And one night we shot a scene where my character Ash gets pulled over by a cop at night on a dark road. And I didn't have any time to prepare for it. I mean, I had already been preparing through the first couple of hours, but immediately when we started shooting, Sandra Bland just came to me. And it just kind of shook me. And, you know, I mean, to me, she is me. She is women that I know. She is women that I grew up with. She's somebody that could be my friend. And so when we shot that, I was like, wow. You know, wow, this is crazy how we are reflecting what is going on in this world today.
And the one really interesting part is you were talking from the perspective of someone being pulled over. Mm-hmm. Mac, you played a police officer who was, you know, at times doing the pulling over and, you know, kind of flips the traditional narrative, what we would have expected to see on camera.
Mm-hmm.
Can you talk about that juxtaposition and what did the way you believe or the way you treat police or the way you see them change after playing a cop on television?
You know, I think even the initial, I know initially reading it, like seeing that, mind you, it's literally in the first few minutes of the show that this happens. It's kind of chronologizing like everything, like from once it happens, what happens after that, like what's going on after that. So when I first read it, I know I was like, whoa, this is heavy. Like this is how we're starting the show. Like this is crazy. So,
and it came at an interesting point because you didn't even know if you wanted to act at the
exactly.
time.
Like I was still in a place where I didn't know if I wanted to just keep doing music and, you know, just focus on that or give that all of my focus or kind of figure out how to play both hands, you know. And I kind of figured if I was gonna do something, then I want to do things that matter, things that'll probably live longer than me. And this script kind of came on my desk at the perfect time. It was like God was like, okay, we're here.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he's amazing in it. I can't wait for you guys to see it. that whole convention, the black cop killing a white kid, actually, you know, when the first trailer came out, it kind of highlighted that. And a lot of people were outraged because...
Wait, really?
Yeah, because... I mean, obviously, that's not the story that's happening in America.
That's true.
In America, it's the opposite. And I think the creators did that so that, because I think it happens so much and we're seeing it all the time on TV, we can kind of get desensitized. So they did it to just wake people up and be like, wait, what is this? What happens is in the first hour, we go down, my character, Ash Aquino, and Preston, my partner, we go down to North Carolina.
Stephon James,
exactly.
Yeah, the man right there.
Yes, exactly. We go down to North Carolina to investigate this murder that Mack Wilde's character did. But in the course of investigating that murder, we discover another murder, another shooting that has happened of a black kid, and we don't know who did it, why they did it, and it's not being investigated. So as we continue throughout the show, it's kind of like, you know, we're peeling back the layers and we're seeing how these two murders are treated differently in the community, in the press, in the justice system. So it's really great in terms of, it's great that we have 10 hours.
Absolutely.
Because
yes.
You can really get into the story.
And the reason why they send you to, especially Preston Terry, Stefan's character, is for optics. It's like, I think it was quoted, it's like you need a black DA to charge
yes.
a black cop.
Yes.
And it's this idea of optics, like what you're seeing is really what's being represented.
Yeah.
Like, let's talk about, like, one other thing is like, he was speaking to a kid, he said, you're not asking the right questions.
Yeah.
You know, are we speaking to our youth correctly? Are we talking to them the right way? Are we raising them the right way? I mean, I don't have any young kids, but are we doing this right?
I think it's, I think all of us are kind of in a state of disillusion in a sense. Like we kind of come up in this place where we're conditioned a certain way. I think this show, well, what we hope we do with this show is open the eyes of everyone to kind of show a fair shake towards everyone's point of view. Like give you a view from every seat in the house, where you might be, you might have empathy for somebody that you usually wouldn't. You know, it gives you an opportunity to look at our country and the people around us every day, our community, our police officers, our you know, just ask the necessary, start to ask the necessary questions and spark the right conversation.
And, you know, it's heavy. It's a heavy subject matter, and I have to just let y'all know, and I think you'll see this after you watch tonight, that it's really entertaining. And so, you know, as artists, we're still entertainers. This is an entertainment piece. This is, there's an amazing soundtrack, yeah, which will probably be an album. You guys are going to be blown away by the music. And, you know, while we're entertaining, we hope to raise consciousness. But it just gets juicier and juicier and juicier, right?
Yeah, it's pretty great. It's pretty great.
So talk about preparing for Ash. Like, you took MMA lessons?
Yes, mixed martial arts. I shadowed a woman who actually does Ash's exact job. Her name is Francesca, and she is a woman of color investigator with the Department of Justice, and she's been there for 20 years, and she used to go undercover in the DEA in Colombia and Mexico, and she really kind of talked to me about, you know, how hard it is to be a woman in law enforcement. Being in law enforcement, period, is the highest stress job of them all. And imagine being a woman, and then on top of it, a woman of color. So we talked a lot about that. I shadowed her. She helped me, you know, with holding the gun and how you go into a room, and just talked about how it's kind of hard for women. You know, you have to have a certain kind of toughness in order to deal with bad guys, and then it's hard to take that hat off when you go home. You know, it's hard to have that personal life and be a law enforcement person. So, and then I did MMA as a workout, and it was actually really helpful because the coach kept saying, okay, when you walk into a room, you know, who's looking out for you? And he actually scared me. Because I was like, wait, I'm not the kind of person that's always looking over my shoulder. He's like, okay, you know, people are always looking to get you. You know what I mean? So, yeah, he got me into the mindset of a fighter.
Yeah, but it seems like that's one thing that you were talking about, being a police officer, and then now you playing a police officer as well, that even in these neighborhoods, like the way we look at police in these neighborhoods, like you growing up in Staten Island, they're also looking at you with the same amount of fear as well.
Absolutely.
And how did your relationship with police change from growing up in Staten Island to playing someone on The Wire that was trying to work at the, with the police working to the detriment of you, to now being a police officer, you know, accused of killing a kid?
You know, I think just, not even just police officers, because, you know, I feel like I have a lot of, I understand the mindset of a police officer because I understand the way that they were trained and everything. I don't excuse them for anything that they do at all, but I can understand the mindset of a police officer. They hear horror stories. They go into these situations scared for their lives a lot of times. Because of one happenstance. And it'll be the same thing for us. We, because of one happenstance, we walk into a situation where police are around us, all the, like a police will stop you, and because of that one friend or that one person that you heard that got pulled over and got hemmed up or anything, all of a sudden you're afraid because you know it could happen to you. So it's the same thing for them. We're automatically walking into a powder keg. So, it kind of gave me a different perspective on police officers, but as a whole, just humanity, to learn not to make snap judgments towards anyone.
And you dealing with, Sanaa, dealing with about to lose your child, you know, this is another interesting plot line that's kind of thrown in, which I feel we see traditionally with black men, but not necessarily with black women. So talk about that plot line and how it plays out through the 10 episodes.
Yeah, you know, just like I was saying before, you know, one of the women that I talked to another woman who was a black woman patrol officer for 20 years, and she wrote a book, Cheryl Dorsey, and she basically talked about how there was so much sexism and racism that there was a time where she was suicidal in her life. And so, like I said before, it's hard to take that hat off. So Ash is kind of dealing with straddling those two worlds. And, you know, sometimes she may not be the best mother, and she's going through a crisis right now because her daughter is her world. But that's, you know, as an actress, those are the things that interest me. I'm interested in doing characters that aren't perfect, that are flawed, that are, you know, there is, you know, in real life, there is no black and white. There's always just shades of gray.
I mean, we're all flawed.
Absolutely. Aren't we? By nature of being human, you're flawed.
It's part of the game.
Exactly.
And I feel like if we're not watching that on television, we're getting inaccurate portrayals of what life really is.
Right.
Absolutely.
One portrayal that I'm interested to see how you all tackle is rioting. Of course, we see in the trailer, we see some of that. And sometimes it's misrepresented as, why would these people destroy their neighborhood? How does this show tackle it? And how do you believe the media tackles rioting as a whole?
I mean, watching television and seeing the rioting, it's kind of scary. Like, they make it seem like a war zone. And they never really kind of give you the understanding of why it's a war zone. But, you know, as soon as you turn on the television, all you see is people throwing rocks and the fire and the broken windows and the buildings being broken into. But you never understand the why. This show, especially, I think it's hour 6, right? That you actually, Jonathan Demme shot it. Shout out to Jonathan Demme. This, you actually get into the why, and you see a group, you know, a community begin to want to fight back, but not necessarily know how. And then you see the local government becoming nervous, so the police becoming militarized, and how, again, it's a powder keg already, so it's just getting bigger and bigger until it explodes.
Yeah, rioting, I mean, it's all coming from an anger that you can't release. And it's just like, you know, something, it just boils over. It's like if you keep feeling oppressed and oppressed and oppressed and not having justice, you're going to just take it into, I think it's also human to blow up. And I think rioting is the nature also of being human, in that you're blowing up and you just need to get it out. Yeah, it's a group.
Martin Luther King once said, rioting is the voice of the unheard. Yeah. Like, we always hear the other, you know, quotes from Martin Luther King, but we don't hear the ones where he was a little more radical. And that is a perfect example of that. I want to talk about the mothers, DeWanda Wise, Jill Hennessy, and how they come together, especially over the one saying, "I'm sorry for your loss." Can we talk about the strength of them and how they possibly pulled from the mothers of the movement right now?
Well, first and foremost, big, big, big shout out to DeWanda Wise and Jill Hennessy for portraying these roles. They, when I say killed, oh my goodness, it's going to ruin you guys. It's going to ruin you guys. Ruin.
Tears.
Seriously. But just to understand the depth and how strong a mother has to be to, how resilient they have to be to still push forward and to continue to live life after losing their child, like something that came from them. It's phenomenal. They do an amazing job at it, and they listen, kudos to them, for real.
Yeah, we talked to Michael Brown. Was Michael Brown's mom?
Yeah, I think Michael Brown's mom was there.
Yeah, DeWanda kind of modeled her character after her. We actually got to talk to a lot of the mothers, and Oscar Grant's mom. So yeah, there is a movement among these women too. That they're turning their pain, which is, I think, beautiful, into kind of activism. And we got to talk to them and get their input. So it was great.
There's a lovely book by Sabrina Fulton and Tracy Martin, Trayvon's parents. And it's like a memoir on Trayvon's life. And do you? One thing that was missed was what Trayvon actually was, as compared to how he was portrayed in the media. Yeah. And how does the show portray the white character of the young son as compared to the black character that's not of the black kid that's not being investigated?
You're gonna have to tune in for that. That's a little much. I mean, you know, it starts tonight, y'all.
Yes.
This is just the beginning. I'm so excited to see how America experiences this epic tale, because there's just, I think it's going to surprise people in terms of the twists and turns that it takes and the perspectives that it takes.
Were there any happy moments shooting on set?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Wait, so Stefan, we weren't going to have a wrap party, and we shot, like I said, it was a grueling 4-month shoot. We all were kind of
summertime
a family. Summertime in Charlotte, North Carolina, which was like
hot,
working in a steam room. And we all
had
to wear like leather jackets and, you know, boots. I was so miserable. And then obviously we're dealing with the subject matter, but we became good friends. And so we weren't going to have a rap party. And then we decided to have Stefan and I hosted a rap party. And we got like the hottest club in Charlotte. And we got, you know, open bar and the hottest DJ. And I've been in this business for 20 years. I really believe that it was like, where are we? I've snapped it. It's on my Instagram.
It's pretty crazy.
It was like the best party I've ever been to in my whole life, because everybody from the cameraman to PA to the producers, all races, were drenched on the dance floor. It was almost like we were just dancing away the stress and the pain.
It was a good time.
It was cathartic, right?
It was a good time.
It was really amazing. I mean, people, we danced until the wee hours of the morning, and I just feel like that was what we needed to do. You know, people saw it on my Instagram. They were like, well, damn, I wish I had came.
So I think we have some audience questions. Who's first?
Hi.
Introduce yourself.
Hi,
I'm Jakara.
Hi, Jakara.
I'm a film student. So I'm very excited to see this, not only because it has such good material to offer audiences, but also as an aspiring and upcoming filmmaker and storyteller and actress myself, I definitely want to see what I can take from this and give to my further experiences. What I wanted to know from y'all is, do you consider being a part of this project a form of activism in itself? And what did you take away from this overall experience personally that reflects how you react and respond to these situations?
Yeah, I mean, I believe, you know, there's a long legacy of artists of all races, but in particular black artists who have galvanized a movement, from Langston Hughes to Zora Neale Hurston, James Baldwin, Lorraine Hansberry, Maya Angelou, Tupac, you know, who use their art to entertain as well as enlighten. And so we took this as a real responsibility, because we know that when you're working on people's heartstrings, and that's what happens with art, you know, you get emotional, you get emotionally connected to the characters, that it can change minds. And I feel like, you know, we hope to entertain, which I know we will, but at the very most, we hope that it'll get people talking to each other, and hopefully, you know, creating some compassion and some empathy and get people to step outside of the little bubbles that we're in. We're very judgmental and divided in this country. So yes, we take it very seriously.
I think we learned how divided we were a few months ago.
Oh yeah. Yes. Oh yeah.
I gotta learn Russian soon. Let's get on to our next question.
Hi, Sanaa and Mack. My name is Chanel, and I have to say you both look amazingly stunning.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
With that said, I've been following both of you with, you know, many characters that you played in different roles. I wanted to know, how do you guys channel in that character each time for each role? Because you both have a way of transcending your characters so well that it kind of manifests through the screen and captures the heart of the people. So I had to ask, how do you channel in your characters to prepare for each role?
And also add how Gina and Reggie helped you with that as well.
I think we had, especially for this role, we had of course, with any role, you have to do research. But with this one in specific, Gina and Reggie kind of gave us like damn near Bibles. Yeah. To kind of read through, which is like different research about the character that you're playing, like all the way down to what school they went to, like what color they like, what time of year they were born, and gives you like a little essay in their voice of like how they would speak, not anything you would ever have to use, but just kind of things to keep in the back of your head about what your character is thinking about, who your character is. And with that, I mean, I know she's been in way more stuff than I have. She's the queen of this. But
yes,
you know, I've never been on anything that's given us that much stuff to go through.
Yeah, Gina and Reggie were so prepared. That's one of the reasons why I wanted to work with them. And Gina again after 17 years with Love and Basketball. We did 17 years ago.
And Disappearing Acts as well.
We did Disappearing Acts right after Love and Basketball. And I know, you know, I come from, you know, a family of artists. And I really believe that what we do as actors is a true craft. And I also believe that it's important. You know, sometimes, especially in America, I think there's a reason why there's a lot of English and Australian actors coming over, because in those countries they actually look up to actors and they look at it as a craft, like you would a doctor. But in America, it's kind of like, oh, you're an actor? What restaurant you working at? You know what I mean? Like,
you get a little jaded.
Yeah, it's like jaded. Oh, I'm a good liar. I could be an actor. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I...
Especially in New York City and LA.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Jesus.
So I come from a long line of people in the entertainment business. And so I really believe, like, if you just think about, like, Monica, for instance, from Love and Basketball, it's 20 years later and people still get something from that character. I take it very seriously. And so, you know, you do all the research, you talk to people who have been through the thing, and then you just, it's really just about letting go, but really just committing and believing how important this work is. I think that's the seed of it for me. But for us, when we were shooting this, every day we would go home and it would be on the news. So a lot of times you have to use your imagination for your research. We didn't have to, it was all there.
It was right there.
It was too much sometimes. There was one day we came in right after Philando Castile got shot. And it was in July. And it was like yet another one.
Yeah.
And he was the one.
It was a crazy week.
If you guys remember, he was the one with the girlfriend in the passenger seat and the baby in the back. And
how strong she was.
Yes.
In delivering it. And not breaking down. I'm sorry to cut you, but
yes,
that was just such a...
It was just so heartbreaking. The baby, too. I just can't get over that. But anyway, the next day, our AD, Pip, a black woman, we're all stunned and yet kind of numb, you know, but she was in tears. And we had to start our day working on this material, and we just had to not start. That day we didn't start. We just had a moment of silence and we had a prayer circle and we really just asked for grace and guidance because we just knew what a responsibility this was. So we went into this knowing that, you know, this is important work.
And that you had to do it right.
And we had to do it right.
We have another question.
Hi, Sanaa and Mack. Thank you so much for being here and using your platform to showcase social injustice in this way. I think you touched on this a little earlier, but in researching your characters in law enforcement, did you discover anything new that doesn't necessarily excuse police brutality, but may uncover some of the challenges they are faced with out in the field, and the general public just may not be aware of?
No, absolutely. Besides just the training, you know, alone, and it's not that it's terrible training. It's just they're trained to the way that they're trained is more so not to save a situation. It's more so to save themselves. Like if something happens, do what you have to do to save yourself, which isn't always right, but they hear horror stories about the ways that it goes wrong. And again, just like I said, one instance turns into a rubric for everyone to go by instead of it just being that one instance. So yes, the training is one thing, but then actually going on these ride-alongs and being in the cop car and being, I guess, associated with police when they're pulling someone over or when we're going through the buildings of Washington Heights and we're seeing the kids and the way that they automatically get defensive towards the police officers. And the police officers get nervous because the kids are trying to grab for something, but you never know what it is, a phone, anything. So it's a very volatile situation that allowed me to look at it, look back at situations that I've been in, and it was like, okay, like I understand, of course, why I'm defensive because that's how I was raised, that's how I was conditioned. But I see that there's two sides to this story.
I had Journey Smollett Bell on a couple weeks ago for Underground, and in a previous interview, she had spoke about how she learned something from every single role that she plays. So before we get out of here, I want to know, what did either of you learn about yourselves from playing Joshua and from playing Ash?
Yeah, that's so true. Because I really believe there's a little bit of destiny involved in the roles that you play. You know, and it's because you have something in your spirit has something to offer the role, but also there's something in the role where you can grow from. And you know what? It's still soon for me to answer that. I think, you know, sometimes it takes a minute to realize what you got. So I'm going to defer. Maybe we can...
Well, what did you learn about from yourself about playing Monica then? We'll go back to Love and Basketball. What did you learn about yourself then?
What did I learn about myself? I really learned that to not give up. Monica never gave up. No matter her love was, you know, in jeopardy, her mother was against her. And even in the audition process for me to get that job, like, I was told no for 5 months. But they were like, well, just, you know, come back again. And everybody in my life said, you know what, give up. You're not going to get the job. This is kind of a little bit emotionally abusive. But somebody was like, you know what, just do it for fun. You're not going to get the job. But just keep doing it. And that lesson right there was great just for my career. You just keep, sometimes it's not about the end result. It's about just putting one foot in front of the other.
Trusting the process.
It's about the journey. And you, Mac?
From Joshua Beck, I think it goes back to kind of what we spoke about. Again, I grew up in a neighborhood where a lot of times we wouldn't even talk to cops, or we would be so familiar with cops, we'd be on a first name basis, like, oh, such and such again? Oh, you getting locked up? Oh, come on. It's a weird relationship.
Yes, yeah.
But
a little cynical.
Yeah. But I think now that I'm so old, right? Now that I'm a little older, and I can look back on myself when I was younger, or see situations that my brothers were in, or my big homies were in, or anything of that nature, I understand a cop's position. I wish that we got back to a place where policing was more of a community service rather than a military type of thing, because that's what it's supposed to be. They're supposed to be public servants. But I think somewhere in translation, between all of the civil rights things, something got lost. And I pray that we get back to a place where police can be what it's supposed to be. But what I learned was more so to look at the humanity of my fellow man rather than looking at what they do, making snap judgments about who they are because of who they hang out with or where they're around. Like, literally finding the humanity of the person. It may take time, but finding that and judging them off of that.
That's beautiful. Thank you so much. And I really hope we get to that place, too, where police is more community policing and not what it currently is. And I hope shows like Shots Fired help us get to that place. Can we please make some noise for Mack Wilde?
Thank you, guys. Thank you.
You could check out Shots Fired, which starts tonight by 8 o'clock on Fox. This is
Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you, guys.